Have you ever wondered how a simple idea transforms into a fully fleshed out 3D masterpiece? From the very first concept to intricate textures, every step is crucial. From an idea in your mind to a breathtaking render on your screen, the journey of 3D modeling is more than just giving life to an idea. It's about mastering a craft that bridges imagination and innovation. Today you shape models, tomorrow your creations will be the beacon inspiring countless future masterpieces. Let's embark on a journey, peeling back the layers of 3D modeling and revealing the magic behind it. When starting a new 3D modeling project, the very first step is to create a concept and gathering reference images. Reference images are essential because they provide a visual guide and accuracy when modeling an object. They help simplify the modeling process, ensure the model looks realistic, and adhere to the desired design. To gather reference images, you can use the free software PureRef, which allows you to create a reference image board. To find references, search online using websites like Pinterest, ArtStation, or Google Image Search, or even use books. Another option is to generate references using AI tools like Midjourney, which is one of my favorite techniques, since it also adds a level of creativity and sometimes creates stuff that doesn't even exist but looks just awesome. When working with references, it's important to understand that using references doesn't mean copying. Even the most skilled artists use references to enhance the accuracy and detail of their work. To work effectively with references, take the time to truly comprehend what you're observing. Avoid over-reliance by selecting a few key references and use references as a guide rather than a blueprint. If you want to see how reference images are used in a project, you can check out the third part of my creature series, where I combine body parts of different animals to create something completely new. Before we jump into modeling, let's pause for a moment. To all the beginners out there who might feel overwhelmed on the journey on becoming a 3D artist, I've been there. But just as you need reference images to create the best models, you also need a guiding hand to navigate the vast world of 3D modeling. If you are new to Blender, I've specially created a course where you can learn the fundamentals and create your first 3D model in just an hour. Even better, using my link in the description gives you a full month free on Skillshare where you can watch it. If you don't like it, you can cancel anytime without even spending one single cent. Let's start modeling. First up, we're diving into basic shapes. Think of it as kindergarten, but with less finger painting and more cubes. This is the blockout stage. Here, we use primitive shapes like cubes and capsules to sketch a rough outline of our final model. If you have reference images from the front or the side, now's the time to bring them in. You might ask, why start with a basic blockout? Well, think of it like building a house. You wouldn't begin with the wallpaper, right? Blocking out helps set a foundation, making sure your object proportions are just right. And why not just jump into high poly sculpting? Well, that's like carving a statue without first defining the rough shape. It's tedious, complex, and can easily overwhelm you. Starting with low poly keeps things simple, allowing for broad changes without hassle. As you work, your poly count will rise, matching the depth of your details. But remember, it's not just about the count. During blockout, our goal is the overall shape. As we refine, the count will grow to catch those nuances. Still, keep an eye out and ensure your hardware keeps cool. In essence, think big picture first, then hone in on the details. Like painting a masterpiece, one deliberate stroke at a time. Remember, a robust foundation sets the stage for all that follows. If you want to see some blockout phases in action, I've added some links in the video description. Next step, sculpting the details. Have you ever stopped to think about why the 3D models you see out there look so damn good? The secret? Alpha textures. Think of an alpha texture as a master artist's cheat code. Rather than spending hours sculpting each tiny detail by hand, alpha textures empower you to stamp details onto your 3D model seamlessly. When it comes to those final touches, the devil's in the details, and alpha textures are the guardian angels. So, what makes them an indispensable tool in every 3D artist's arsenal? Efficiency. Imagine having to chisel every single scale on a majestic dragon, or the wrinkles that bring a face to life. With Alpha Textures, it's just as easy as a click and drag of your mouse. Consistency. Uniformity is key in design. Alpha Textures ensure that the patterns you etch into your masterpiece have a consistent touch, giving it a professional finish. High quality. The alphas out there are not just random pictures, they are crafted by industry professionals with one goal in mind: to make your 3D model stand out. Now you might ask yourself, where can I get my hands on these game changers? While the internet is vast with resources, ArtStation has always been my go-to. As for me, I not only use Alpha Textures, I craft them. Each one tailored with passion and precision, suited for various projects. And the best part? I upload all the Alpha Textures I design and use in my videos to my Patreon page, together with Blender project files, 3D models and more. So why not empower your creations while supporting an artist you trust? Okay, but how do you use these Alpha Textures now? You could add details directly on your final shape sculpt from the last phase, or first go through retopology, we'll cover this next, then utilize the multi-resolution modifier for adding details. I lean towards the latter approach. It gives more flexibility and allows for detail work on a cleaner topology. This ensures better deformation and performance. I've covered this topic in multiple videos, so check the video description if you want to know more. No matter which way you go, later you'll convert these details into a normal map, a 2D texture that creates the illusion of depth, saving computational power when rendered. The big question: how detailed should you go if details are later replaced by a texture? There is a sweet spot. Scars, wrinkles, surface damage, perfect for sculpting. Fabric patterns, scratches or skin pores, best left for texturing. Lastly, remember, while details enhance your model, they shouldn't overshadow your main design. Always focus on the overall character or object you're creating. Meaning, even the best details look bad on a poor model. In the previous step, we perfected our sculpt, adding all the details. Now, let's discuss an essential part of 3D modeling: topology. Topology, simply put, is the layout of polygons on your 3D model. It guides the flow of geometry, influencing deformation, light interaction, and performance in game engines. During sculpting, we often use a high poly count to capture all the details. But for real-time applications like games or animation, we need a low poly version with clean topology. That's where retopology steps in. It's the process of creating a new optimized mesh for your model. Think of it as giving your model a facelift, but you're reducing polygons instead of wrinkles. Why is retopology so crucial? Performance. A high poly mesh can be too heavy for real-time use. Low poly versions ensure smooth performance without quality loss. Animation. Clean topology is vital for natural deformation. It ensures that the mesh bends and moves naturally without artifacts or distortion. UV unwrapping. Unwrapping a 3D model to a 2D texture map is easier with good topology. Or let's say, you will have a hard time UV unwrapping your model when the topology is just messed up. But how many triangles should your final model have? It varies, based on model complexity, use case, camera distance and more. A general rule? Aim for minimal polygons without compromising model detail. For beginners, this probably sounds like the worst advice ever. But believe me, this will come naturally as you're getting more experienced. Since retopology is a topic that cannot be avoided, I have a dedicated video about it. Check the link in the description. When retopologizing, several tools can help. Popular ones include RetopoFlow for Blender and the QuadriMeshup paid add-on. I prefer manual retopology because I'm a masochist. Yeah. No, I mean, as automated tools don't always satisfy me. I'd only use automated retopology for render-only models. In conclusion, after countless hours perfecting your model, it's time to recreate a version that just looks like its budget twin. Soon, you'll see what happens to your high-poly masterpiece. After retopology, we now have a model that looks like a cheap knockoff of your old version. But don't fret, we are far from done. Up next, UV mapping and unwrapping. UV unwrapping is all about converting a 3D modeled surface into 2D coordinates. Imagine wrapping a gift. You start with a flat wrapping paper, wrapping it neatly around the object. In UV unwrapping, you do this with a 2D texture on a 3D model, and the result is called a UV map. But why is this necessary? UV mapping acts as the link between your 3D model and the 2D textures. It guarantees that textures sit correctly on your model, thus ensuring optimal results. Like any 3D modeling phase, UV maps can be a hit or miss. A quality UV map maximizes texture space, keeps seams discreet, and avoids visible stretching. A bad UV map, on the other hand, is like wrapping a gift with too little or too much paper. You end up with gaps, overlaps, and a lot of frustration. As for everything, there are tools for UV unwrapping. Blender offers its built-in functionality, but third-party add-ons can enhance the process. One such add-on is UV Packmaster, which excels in maximizing texture space. But as for any tool, it doesn't take away your work, it just makes it easier. And as with wrapping presents, the more effort and precision you invest, the more commendable the outcome. Post the annoying stages of retopology and UV unwrapping. Our model is primed for the next phase, texturing. What exactly is texturing? In essence, texturing is the process of applying 2D images to your 3D model to give it color, detail, and realism. It's like painting your model, but instead of a brush, you use pixels. Now, you might wonder, how do you texture a model? There are several ways, but the most common method involves a dedicated texturing software. You can either paint directly onto your model in 3D or use the UV map in 2D. It's similar to coloring a book, but here you stay within the UV islands. Blender offers its own texturing tab for this, but trust me, if you're serious about texturing, you might want to consider Substance Painter. It's specifically designed for texturing. Imagine a gourmet kitchen packed with tools and ingredients for amazing textures. Contrast that with Blender, which is like a Swiss Army knife. Useful, but not always the best tool for a specific job. Substance Painter's interface is intuitive, it has a huge library of materials and brushes, and features like particle brushes, projection painting, and a real-time PBR viewport where you can see exactly how your textures will appear in a game engine. Remember our high poly model discussion? When you start texturing, you can use details from that high poly model and transfer them onto 2D textures. This technique? It's called baking. It creates an illusion of detail without the hefty polygon count, and it's essential for animation and game engines. So, in summary, texturing is like giving your model a makeover. It's about adding color and detail to bring your model to life. And while you can do this in Blender, using a dedicated texturing software like Substance Painter can make the process a lot more enjoyable and efficient. After mastering foundational steps in 3D modeling, from collecting references to mastering texturing, you might be wondering, what's next? From a simple cube, your model has transformed into a detailed textured masterpiece. There is a vast world of possibilities ahead. One direct use of your model is rendering. Think of it as a snapshot of your 3D creation, showing off its details in all the splendor. Using Blender's render engines like Cycles or Eevee, you can get photorealistic or stylized looks. People use rendering for product design, architectural visuals, or just showcasing their work. To get top-notch renders, you need a grasp on composition and lighting. But don't worry, many tutorials can guide you. Have a character? Why not animate it? Animation breathes life into your models. Using tools like Blender's Rigify, you can rig and animate your creations. With keyframes and physics simulation, they can walk, jump, or even dance. But remember, animation is its own art. It demands time and dedication, just like modeling. Want to make your model interactive? Bring it into a game engine. Using platforms like Unity or Unreal Engine, you can prep your 3D model for gaming. But game engines need optimization. You have to optimize your textures, your meshes, create multiple models with increasing poly counts, so-called LODs, that are replaced based on the camera distance, and so on. This is another story. Of course, there are many more use cases for your model. In summary, from references to texturing, your model's potential is endless. It could be a captivating render, an animated film star, a game piece, or even a printed object you hold in your hand. And in a delightful twist, your carefully crafted model might inspire future artists. You've not only drawn inspiration, but become a source of it.